It's the fleeting year 2004, near the end of it actually. The Sims 2 came out only a few weeks ago and kicked the franchise from nostalgic 2D backgrounds to the 3D world of the early 2000s, replacing the widely and varying deadly situations flailing low poly arms with big eyes and newfound expressive faces. Meanwhile, in the real world is the comforting millennium pop wave, which had hit surprisingly many parts of the world, full of carefree girl-such boy bands, R&B, raves, over-the-top sci-fi CGI, Matrix/Born party aesthetics, and music videos that finally opened up the editor profession to Hume's fifth best friend, the hummingbird, ebbing and fading out. Slightly outside of this influx had the Black Eyed Peas maneuvered their way into the mainstream with newly added member Fergie and some song titles that only could happen more than 10 years ago. In 2004, they swam in popularity from last year's album, Elefunk, its last single release being only recent. At the same time, something else was also comfortably riding high on the water. Talking about the end of the PS2 would have even in the years to come been a bit too early. Most people were so settled with a favorite DVD player that they just intrinsically knew that even in the near future they would have to keep surgically removing their spitting cheetah children from the SingStar microphones. Of course, that popular platform in combination with a popular franchise, including peculiar crossovers, a movie only existing in eternal planning, and so many spin-offs that they will fill an entire museum someday, would result in some PS2 Sims games. The first one being a version of the first Sims game that is so deeply ingrained into my childhood that it already broke through planet Earth, haunting the oceans near Australia, followed by the more forgotten Bustin' Out without a G, because 2000s, where the Sims can now go to places, I think? However, these were apparently not the first planned PS2 releases. According to Wikipedia, a game started development before both in 2002, but fell into delay around the 2003 release of the Making Magic add-on due to staff issues, resulting out of parts of the development team being assigned to Bustin' Out Without a G. To help the marketing of this ailing project, EA called the Black Eyed Peas to the rescue. Yes, in this fateful year of 2004, all the 2000 streams were finally crossed, leading to the materialization of this video's topic, the Herbs, Sims in the City, which came out on the PlayStation 2, GameCube, GBA, and the at the time fresh Nintendo DS. But today we are taking a look at the PS2 version, brought to you by an emulator. If anyone watches this, please excuse some speed and graphic hiccups, thanks! You start the game, which by the way you can also play with another player in couch co-op, which is not part of this review. It feels like I forgot something. No, that's irrelevant. The very first thing to do is to choose one of the districts as a starting point that are not only introduced with that small text, but also a comics with an X on the net. Are you serious? Yes, I am. It's 04. The districts range from rock enthusiasts, nerd geek chic, full-blown hip-hoppers, to even people swallowed by candy wrapping, represented in almost every little weirdly aged story with a different art style, which is nice. All of them star Jade, the poster girl of the game, a thing regularly attempted in the late 90s and early 2000s. Who was featured prominently in trailers, on the box art, the intro of the game, and even as the standard up in the editor. But you can just crush Max's dreams of establishing a virtual star by making your own 2000s time-traveling OC up, which does not get influenced by your district choice. Overall, your options in clothing and body type are really limited, as expected, and you can't choose your personality whatsoever. But you can, for some unknown but probably funny reason, modify your orb's face with a somewhat Elder Scrolls Oblivion-like sliding menu thingy into resembling the love child of all the monsters under your bed. But I personally am just not that kind of person, so I tried to make my orb Tubington Jr. as handsome and fitting of that name as I could. So the story begins? Does it even have a story? Before answering this question, I think I should put something into perspective. A console port of a life simulator opens up a problem. Lack of memory space on a console has to bring with it less options across the creative customization board, and many compromises like a limit on how many objects you can place in buy mode. Adding to that, in the pre-internet console days, is only cumbersome or even impossible expansion of the game's content with add-ons or even mods. Combine all that and you get several approaches to a Sims port. Some focus on the contents of one expansion, especially if it can be turned into a pet-vet game, but I don't mean that. Instead, you as a developer either let most players bore their way through a Sims game, in which they probably can't really produce the exact Sim with the exact hair, voice and career they wanted, like the video game equivalent of a repetitive, but surprisingly zen-like aquarium that is the 3DS port of Sims 3 in my opinion, which I just happen to own. Or you can build a story around the limited scope to spice up the overall playing experience. And in my opinion, thankfully most console ports did that. On the one side, we have Sims games with a loose overarching goal to reach through playing in several houses / levels, the game expanding with your progress. For example, moving out of your mom's house just to then couch surf at your friends to eventually someday become a hypercapitalist who can buy hearts, or at least a heart-shaped bed. On the other end of the spectrum, we have Sims games with a story. Yes, a story. Like, for example, uncovering an alien conspiracy. While still more loose in definition than, say, insert modern story-driven game, they have completing a list of tasks in a mission structure as a requirement to move on with the story, even if it's still in the boundaries of the Sims gameplay. Sometimes they have dialogue and more defined characters, relying less on the gradual moving to a bigger accommodation shtick, even if it does need more explaining. Of course, we also have the ones right seated in the middle, like The Sims 2 on Nintendo DS, which has a relatively defined cast, but its main focus being on renovating an abandoned hotel, till you get distracted by putting on a red suit and aliens or something. Which was a thing in The Sims 2 days, and I totally did not cheat to that point because I had no patience as a 12-year-old with a certain DS card in 2011. Nintendo, please don't sue me. But on which side of the spectrum does the orbs for PS2 and GameCube fall on? Straight to the left, nothing more, nothing less. Your main goal is to become the most popular with all the orbs with a Z, and all the crowds and all the districts with an S. That's it. This dude named Darius, who's like the respected boss of everybody with his face plastered in every district, despite him not having to constantly utilize social camouflage, is surprisingly willing to help you, potentially replacing him as the most popular up someday. That's a nice thing of him to do actually. But he keeps sending messages every 10 minutes on your proto smartphone, which gives me digital non-robotance war flashbacks. But back to the beginning. You get a nice walk with Will.i.am from the Black Eyed Peas. And before you ask, it's of course not the first time The Sims had a star cameo. In the very first expansion of the very first Sims game, you had Drew Carey come to your polygonal party. The cameo counter only got higher with the only expansion my mom still had, where you got guest appearances by the then at the time contemporary mainstays like Avril Lavigne, Christina Aguilera, Jon Bon Jovi, yeah, and commercialized beyond death oddballs like Andy Warhol and Marilyn Monroe, and downloadable NPCs such as Sarah McDonald McLaughlin, who is the singer behind, among others, the song Possession. Yeah, the song about taking your breath away. I at least know that one. And she's still an active musician, apparently. Good for her. And Freddie Prinze Jr., who starred in I Know What You Did Last Summer. Heard of that one. And the Scooby-Doo live-action movies, yeah. And is now more known as a voice actor with roles such as James Vega and the Iron Bull? Life is indeed interesting. But back to the topic at hand. While not as much present as later celebrities on the covers of their Sims products, the Black Eyed Peas sure were a part of the game. Not only did they re-record soundtracks in Simlish, and through for some immersion-breaking reasons, some of their non-Simlish studio versions into the soundtrack, but of course they also appear as herbs, so you can hug and tickle your way through a 2000s hit group and watch them do stuff. And yes, there's a Sims Wiki entry for Fergie, and if you squint, maybe she looks like Fergie if I had to draw her from memory in maybe 30 years or so. But it probably was not the easiest task to integrate real-life people in this 2000s parody comic cross cartoon cross Brad art style they were going for. Very likely by young adults and or older teenagers slash children wanting to be said young adults, the target audience in mind. In contrast to the all-ages Americana vibe of Sims 1, that was a realistic escapism for boring adults and a doll box for children. I at least did not expect to someday witness the sight of all those Sims, I meant herbs, with those nose and nipple piercings. But now back to the beginning. At your new home, that is actually not in your chosen district, but in a slightly worrying neighborhood right next to it, you immediately impress will.i.am with a random guitar power social. More on that later. He then gives you a shower, a couch, and a stereo as a welcome gift, but no toilet. Every shop in every district sells distinct furniture, even if the overall variety is still small in comparison to other Sims games, so at least later you can put a scary looking street stall into your lot of solitude. And all of that can be placed via your proto smartphone, which also lets you call services I personally never used non-accidentally, and shows you your relations, but not a button to enter item placement mode. I know it's actually listed in the manual, but if you have one button prompt on screen, why not the other important one too? Just asking. When you're done with creating a digital representation of the maybe most saddening way to live, you can head out to your first district, in my case the Biker and Rocker themed Gasoline Row. And here the biggest part of the gameplay begins. Your task is to raise your reputation by positively interacting with the local herb population. This includes, in no particular order, networking, aka talking, greetings, icebreakers, being friendly, or just an horrible and social herb. When getting closer to other herbs, they may teach you more social actions, but are often far away from the family-friendly nature of the original Sims, because we are now T for teens! Or 6 for literal first graders here in Germany. So we now have all those things you should ideally not do, like having a random cage fight with a stranger, gambling, getting delighted on oxygen, sabotaging someone's business, almost drinking presumably alcohol. If someone hadn't snatched away right in front of my herb's face, almost splitting fire into someone else's face, and even littering. It's a morbid surprise that the dead don't strand regularly on Skyline Beach. By the way, it was for me as a person whose maybe first memory was watching someone play the first Sims game, shocking to find out that even that has an ESRB T14s, in contrast to nowadays a USK 0 rating. Culture's weird. Moving on. While you can just talk or Whatever that is. To the other herbs in your shabby standard outfit. Your interactions will be more successfully performed if you deck yourself out in a locally common gown you can buy in clothing stores in every district. Despite limited options that can lead to really awkward meetings, it's not that difficult to let mine and probably everybody else's questionable 2000s clothing taste shine. With a high enough reputation, you can even achieve a mascot's dream of putting a weird-looking version of your herb's face on a shirt. And before someone asks, yes, I tried to get one weird 15 simoleon 2000s tattoo for every district, but not every district lets your herb pursue such a fast and flippant 10-second decision. So that aspect may or may not be 100% historically accurate. But this 2000 style can cost several hundreds of simoleons, which you can earn with your local, slightly suspicious job opportunities, including the classic stuff like bartending, skateboarding for tips, or taming ferrets and putting them into boxes so they can be sold? Every single one of these includes only a slightly shifted 4-button controller memory test. While you have to juggle those with other things like talking to customers or cleaning after their existence, this gets mitigated by you just bashing yourself through the button prompt and then tending to everything else, one after another. The higher job levels don't add more variety, just more of the same things stacked on top of each other. It does not help that on the highest level of every job, the game for some reason lets you babysit this janitor by you controlling him, so he can go, for example, to the toilet. Yes, with enough talking you can control other herbs by adding them to your group. It is used for some side missions you get from other herbs, in which you spray over graffitis, make pictures of herbs, and take control of other herbs to try to make them dress differently. But there was not the right clothing in the district the herb was in, and you can't send them somewhere else, so I'm sorry for this herb. Finally, with the right clothing in combination with a high enough reputation, will this teleporting or doorman let your herb into the one exclusive VIP room every district has, which contains furniture that apparently better fills up your needs, namely hygiene, hunger, energy, fun, and of course, a non-exploded bladder. Due to these needs draining rather fast, the developer seemingly preventively added in every district a random sleeping room, spots for food, but no showers. It caused immersion, I thought, but then here's the toilet, so . Another problem needs turned out to be fun of all things, because that contact is apparently not entertaining. Then I found out that herbs seem to have fun drinking alcohol for some reason. Besides that, need for ferment. You also have to meet Darius at midnight parties in said VIP rooms, so it can give you a power social unique to the district that gets activated with this, in my opinion, irrelevant quick time event. Power socials are consumables that you should not waste on normal herbs, because you need them to get rid of the three villains. Yes, villains that appear when you stay too long in one district and harass you out of money in front of said normal herbs you want to impress. But a race in fame or infamy doesn't limit itself to the VIP room of one district. If that number right to the somewhat level up bar is high enough, a snub will unsolicitedly contact and finally allow you to enter another district. Yes, this click system is this integral to this town named Herbsville. And there you repeat everything till you get another empty apartment. Nice for the Sims players that like furnishing stuff, but I personally never ended up entering it more than once, because moving my stingy toilet? No! My apartment was left relatively vacant anyway, with my herb basically living in the district. Besides me occasionally having to place upgrade peripherals needed to progress to the aforementioned higher level versions of jobs there. That will hurt your farm! And if you chase out all villains, out of every district you get Darius penthouse, I think, but I stopped after being able to enter VIP lounges in all districts. Random Herb starting to dress up like my Herb for some random non-personal reasons. And a Zeppelin being graced with my Herb's face. And here, we move to the N, to the I, to the T, to the P, I, X, nitpicks! I meant nitpicks. Herbs are often in the way, either of you or the camera. The district layouts, despite having always the same basic elements, are a bit confusing. Something else about your Herb's surroundings also seems to stick out. You see these two doors on this bathroom and you think, how immersive! Then you turn the camera to find out they lead to the same room. Almost all doors are doubled, and that for a good reason. Because of Nod, you get such a frightening nightmare scene with Herb stuck on both sides of one door. But even on good days, the bouncer will not let you into the VIP section without his unskippable animation. An unpleasant waiting experience you will also have every time you leave your sad lot and enter a district. While most of these are filled with unique items, some, however, noticeably reused ones from not really fitting districts. The fact that your Herb does not take off a hat while sleeping or showering. Similar to other Sims console games, but this is the nitpick section, okay? In the showerless districts, you have to help yourself with really religious hand washing, which gets more tedious than it already is due to you not being able to stack up the same action on one object. The developers apparently tried to mitigate that by often placing another copy of the object right next to it, so you can switch between them, but that is really only a lackluster solution. This one time I invited Herbs into my lot of solitude and they just did not leave for a while. Tedious stuff during the clothing menus, like for example having to hold the circle button to preview your potentially even worse clothing choices. The dramatizing fact that your Herb eats sushi like a steak, not only with a fork like the clumsy of humanity, but also a knife. A knife! Knife! Prominently immersion-breaking product placements targeting the young adult audience. Yes, you can kick a digital Red Bull vending machine. Of course, this is not the first time in a Sims game, but it leaves the same important question open. Is human lettering a normal thing in this game, or did I just miss the Simlish letters? But there are some instances where Sims mix English phrases into their vocabulary, even in the first Sims game. Is this just that? Does this mean there are English-speaking countries in the Sims universe? Like there were countries in the Sims 3 Road Adventures. They had different cultures, but they also spoke Simlish. Does this mean that they just happened to have developed the same language? Or was there colonization? Or where were other people but not anymore? And the Sims took their place? Are we gonna get replaced by sorry, moving on. And of course not everything is bad. Let your nostalgia out of its cage, because it's positive nitpick time! While the mentioned formulaic outlines of the areas are noticeable, it does get a bit balanced out by the overall differing design aesthetics, including a rich people district high up on an actual skyscraper. The soundtrack is a nice slice of the early 2000s, and at least for me, this sounds surprisingly nice. But of course I can't use that extensively in this video because the Black Eyed Peas. And I like my safety, and the safety of my family. Apropos 2000s, I like that the game is a little time capsule of an over-the-top version of that decade. We don't have that often actually. The animations, while long, and some of it repeating frequently overall, still have the trademark Sims charm. Especially all the failed states of all those social actions are something to behold. According to the Sims Wiki, this game was the first one in the series with dynamically changing weather, something later games did profit from. And I think Herbs protecting themselves with newspapers and umbrellas is a kinda cute detail. Look at them! The shopkeepers actually compliment or mock your horrible clothing changes in Simlish. I also like that there are also herbs you can interact with, which sadly isn't the case with this random police officer or accidentally this fireman. I am totally forgetting something. I can't. It can't be important if I forgot. Sorry, anyways. Even if they are often in the way, it's cool to have the other herbs around and to see that they also get gold or red reputation stars when interacting with other NPC herbs. Like other Sims games, you can smooch or body bonk everybody, regardless of gender. That's nice. These cool looking sunglasses! This humorously small distance my herb covers on this motorcycle. You can zoom in and out during pausing, and I'm not sure why I appreciated that so much, to be honest. I only later found that out, but you can't change the design and ringtone of your proto-smartphone. And somewhat unrelated to the game, the inventory button prompt thing made me at least look up an old game FAQ walkthrough, and while this particular one had none, it made me look up some older ones to appreciate the sadly now almost gone art of ASCII images. I think they look neat. But before we get to the conclusion now, do you remember that I said the herbs came not only out on stationary consoles, but also on handhelds? These versions aren't just the same with downgraded graphics. You need to know that many Sims console ports may have the same name, but are completely, and I underline completely, different games besides really basic gameplay similarities and plumbob sprinkled in. The handheld herbs, and I can only talk here about the DS version from personal childhood experience, falls with a mission structure and dialogue on the right side of the story spectrum. While it's not the best written game humanity has ever seen, it's still tinged in early 2000s lingo, this font, and I can't recall from memory if every aspect of it aged that well. I still had to chuckle when I played a bit for this video. I personally also liked that the player character has a more defined personality than their console counterpart. Of course, the game also suffered from too needy needs and probably repetitive gameplay if we go by me never finishing it as a 12-year-old. And its character models could also be a bit less scaring me for restless nights of sleepless thinking for my taste. But overall, I personally would say that this should be the one herbs game to play nowadays. Unless you want to really dive into the 2000s clicks and fashion, enjoy customizing your digital apartments more than I do, or feel nostalgic for the early 2000s as a whole, the Black Eyed Peas, or even this game itself. Or play the PSP version of Sims 2. It's hilarious, in my opinion. Yes, I'm serious. It's quite good. Maybe play it on an emulator to fast forward some of the walking. Okay, I go back to the console ops already, okay. At the end of the day, the ops sold below expectations and the potential franchise was dead before it came far from the nest. Allegedly a Dreamcast, a PSP and a PC port that would have made my life so much easier were also buried in time. A sequel that, according to the Sims Wiki, started development after the announcement of the first game, was apparently cancelled mid-development, but some assets were funded back into the PS2 port of the second Sims game. Which, and no one who has watched this video this far will believe this, I have not played before starting production of this video. But at least Jade got a few cameos in following console releases of the Sims 2 era. And what about the Black Eyed Peas? They gave video games another shot in 2011 with the Black Eyed Peas Experience, a dancing game for Wii and Xbox 360. Then, probably unrelated to it, Fergie left the group on good terms in 2018 to spend more time with her son, and probably to better avoid hearing the words National Anthem for the rest of her life. The remaining trio then immediately repeated history by going back to their original and less confusing name, Black Eyed Peas, adding with J-Ray Soul a new female semi-official member and releasing music to this day. An okay outcome for everybody, I guess. But back to the games. So why did the ops fail? Critics at the time of course saw the same issues that are just inherent to a console Sims game. Too much the same like The Sims, without as many creative opportunities or options, leading to too much repetition and overall not as good as The Sims 2. Thanks, GMR Magazine. In my opinion, this could have been at least fought a little bit by diversifying the repetitive button pressing minigames with, say, different prompts, maybe even with different timing, and adding them to more social actions instead of just power socials for some reason. Or this could just been my brain subconsciously telling me to play more than 2 hours of Shadow Hearts, but pile of shame. Admittedly, this repetitiveness and the overall lack of items, clothing and polish, and an at least for me glaring presence of seemingly last minute developer workarounds probably could only have been solved by more development time for the final iteration of the game. However, this move would have likely not played to the game's advantage. Looking at its long development and its focus on at the time contemporary young adult lifestyle and clothing trends, I personally would also suspect, or at least as much as a then-proud 5-year-old could, that its style probably was already a bit dusty on release day. As our fleeting acquaintances at GMR Magazine pointed out, it also did not help that the herbs was put on store shelf shortly after the release of Sims 2 on PC, and additionally tried to establish a new brand with the herbs, using the established The Sims, only on the small patch in the corner of the cover that has this weird orange-brown background that could work on its own, but looks at least to me a bit jarring with the characters and the European blue PlayStation 2 case, despite actually successfully communicating what this game is about. In my opinion, they should have just used the background of this presumably Japanese cover if they really had to put characters on the box art. I however suspect that something else at the time had probably KO'd the herbs. The very next year, The Sims 2 maybe hammered the coffin nails with the very first 3 add-ons, University, Nightlife, and Open for Business, that were also catering to more mature audiences and the ones that want to be like them. These add-ons showed that The Sims could jump into more young adult waters without throwing out its light-hearted, slightly goofy style and relying on specific, fast-fading youth trends as really edgy pool noodles. But even with the cover, and it at the time being properly flattened on the young adult video game market, the herbs could nowadays have become maybe something of a nostalgic, cult classic sleeper hit to look back on, if it hadn't, and I'm quoting the Sydney Morning Herald here, a mistaken emphasis on conservative conformity. I know most people don't play a game to really think about its implications, but I think at least most people are always destined to grow out of a personality entirely reliant on buying clothing to be part of a shallow clique that could and will just replace you eventually. Or to quote GamesRadar, it is a Sims light with a 12-year-old's vision of life painted glossily on top. You'll either love it or hate it, depending on your view of games and the world. And if I am honest, and not in the everything my younger self did was cringe, because I'm so totally less cringe now, of course, kind of way, 12-year-old me would have leapt up the scenario about those cliques with an over-the-top clothing code, living in their own exclusive habitat, basically with their own society. While this is not in and of itself a bad thing, regardless of what everybody who was 12 once would try to convince you, but then more self-awareness, even if child me would have not fully understood it, could have made it at least for me age better. And it could have went at least a little bit in that direction at some point. The Herbs 2004 E3 trailer featured probably a homeless person and a street performer that both didn't seem to belong in any of the cliques or even in basic service jobs. But of course those two NPCs didn't make it into the final game. And nowadays, where environmental awareness, the wage gap, and the focus on the value of human beings seem to be on the rise with the prospects of having to readjust life after this, it just moves further and further away from our understanding, while also not having fun dialogue. Yeah, just saying. In the end, we maybe just grew out of the optimistic early 2000s childhood that the Urbs inhabited. But just maybe because of that, I personally can't wait for the 2000s revival wave in the 2070s or something, when the 80s wave may have waned at least a little bit. But we should not forget, and I don't want to be ridiculously cheesy in this weird PS2 Sims game review no one will watch, but I think we sometimes don't realize that all those irrelevant seeming shallow things of the past influenced us into who we are now. Everything filled with brands, commercialism, and fleeting happiness, but happiness indeed. Of course, nostalgia blinds us on the daily, lets us forget most negative things of the soothing past we try to hide in. But even with a bit of realism, a look on the years behind us does not need to be all negative either. Sometimes it just shows us what beautiful moments we want to see in the future again, and what mistakes we should not repeat, because that's the only thing you can do. Before someone invents time travel and enslaves us all or something. But what I wanted to say in conclusion. Just don't forget that we all were happy once. Probably. Somewhat. And we can theoretically become happy again sometime in the future. Maybe. Maybe not. I never said that I know. Until then, a big part of humanity can at least suffer together in the comment section of the 2020 New York New Year's ball drop. Peace out! This ending monologue is perfect! The smoke sure did get to her.
Why are you looking and sounding like me? Why are you let go of me? What did happen?
Nostalgia sure can fry your brain, but be thankful that I even carry your weird body despite you not listening to
Why
me.
Why do I have clones? I think it's the smoke.
You're a clone too. I want the smoke left my lungs long ago. You're so heavy.
Why is my laptop burning over there?
Wow, you're changing subjects a lot.
How am I supposed to make this masterpiece of a video?